Thank you, Freya. Thank you, everyone. First of all, I would like to thank Parasite for this invitation, Cosmin, Freya, and Chang for all the technical preparation. Before I begin, I would like to clarify my point of enunciation. I speak from the perspective of an art historian based within the Black diaspora, as experienced between France and England, and as a curator of Cameroonian heritage, working within these multiple territories and beyond. The title of my presentation came as a response to the premise of this conference after having discussed it with Cosmin and Freya. And my presentation is not going to be about asserting certitudes, but it's rather about a series of questions that my research and curatorial practice and the art I observe around me, notably in what is loosely called contemporary African art, is increasingly leading me to ask. I'll start with an anecdote. In 1940, the Johannesburg Art Gallery bought its first work by a black artist, a painting by an artist called Gerard Sekoto, who's known as one of Africa's pioneers of modern art, African modern art. When Sekoto went to see his painting, he wasn't allowed entry at the gallery. It was before apartheid, but there were already racially biased group area laws denying black people access to white spaces. For a long time for us, you know, as black people, galleries have represented white spaces, excluding black people. And this is something that has informed the early stage of my research. And exclusion and marginalization continue to be issues that I seek to address in my curatorial practice. So for this presentation, initially I wanted to skip this part, but I felt that within the context of Hong Kong, there might be some narrative and some art historical, an art history actually that maybe needs to be shared here. And I'm aware that if I was in England or in France, I might not be doing the same kind of presentation. It's not, nothing's happening. Ah, okay. Right, so I'll start a little bit by explaining how I came to look, you know, to look into marginalization, starting from when I was a student, actually. And in a way, even if it was in the 90s, in a way, I feel like I've been, you know, keep on doing the same thing. But basically, when I was a student in Paris in the mid-90s, I enrolled in contemporary art, history of art. And the year we had to decide on the topic of our essay, there was an exhibition at the Pompidou Center called Made in France, 50 years of creation in France, so spanning the dates 1947-1997. Which were actually the dates that Gerard Sekoto, the painter I just mentioned, moved to Paris. So he came to France in 1947, died in Paris in 1993. And as I was a naive student, I went to the Pompidou Center thinking, you know, because this exhibition was about the foreign artists who had come to France, you know, set up their studios there and, you know, had practice from Paris. And Gerard Sekoto was one of, you know, foreign artists who had come to France. And in 1997 was the second Johannesburg Biennial. And, you know, it was a few years after the abolition of, the demise of apartheid. And there was a sort of interest in contemporary South African art. So naively, I went to the Pompidou Center thinking I would see some work by Gerard Sekoto. And went there and saw that there was no Gerard Sekoto and no representation of black artists. So I was a student at the time, and I was interested actually in sort of Russian art and German art as well, the new reality, Neue Sachlichkeit. I can never pronounce in German. But then I decided that it was important to address this underrepresentation and exclusion of black artists, not only from national collections, because the Pompidou Center, this exhibition was actually a display of the collection of the National Museum of Musée National d'Art Moderne, National Museum of Modern Art, and also to address the absence of contemporary Black artists in art history, and in this instance, French art history. So I'm just going to show a few images of. Actually met Gérard Sékoto when I was 12 years old. He was a family friend, so this is a photograph by George Hallett of Gérard Sékoto in front of his painting, homage to Steve Biko, and the painting is dated 88. And Gérard Sékoto is one of the first Black artists to have addressed and represented the Black figure in South African art from the late 30s. He wasn't the only one, but he was one of the first to give the black figure a sort of dignifying representation in South African art, where at the time, historically, with the influence of European art, Black figures were represented at the same level as the flora and the fauna. So I'm just trying to get this image to. So this is a painting, one of his early paintings from the late 1930s, which to me is very important because it shows the idea of black self-representation. It's a street photographer, and you see people, queuing to be photographed. He's also represented the townships in South Africa, so Sophiaton, in Johannesburg, and his work is very much sort of in tune with the sort of representation or discourses of the time. And here's an image of Constance Stuart Larrabee, who documented, who was one of the first actually female South African photographer. And I'm just showing a few images of Gerard's work. This is the waiting room dealing with migrant workers in South Africa. So people going to probably to work in the mines, prison yard. Note the interesting aesthetic style of Gérard Sékoto and the representation of what was to become sort of a. What was to epitomize South African anti-apartheid struggle with the majority of Black people oppressed by a minority of white people. So you see one white guard and many more prisoners. Same sort of a dynamic or sort of power relationship between the white overseer and the Black workers. So after this work, Gérard Sékoto came to Paris, continued to paint, was notably inspired by Miriam Makeba, who was a singer and anti-apartheid activist in a way. And he started to create this series called the Blue Head, which obviously it's not it's the kind of art from the 60s, and it's a particular aesthetic. But if you place it in the context of Black representation in Paris in the 60s, where you would see more kind of like a stereotypical racist representation of Black people, here's where representation of Black women as a sort of a muses. And after going to Senegal, he was interested in he created a series called The Senegalese Women. So there's a series of painting. So going to Senegal in 1966, he went there for the Festival of Negro Art. And it was the first time he ever returned in Africa after he left South Africa. So I did, I decided, I mean, when I was younger and I knew Gerard Sekoto at the time, I wasn't really interested in art. And so it's something that it's only maybe 10 years after Gerard Sekoto's death that I sort of realized what privilege I had to, you know, meet Gerard and other South African exiles who lived in Paris and England in the 80s. So as I said, when I was, when I took up art, history of art, I decided to write my essay on his practice for my the equivalent of the masters in France, and I focused on his what Marlin Martin, the former director of the South African National Gallery, called the social realism, but also the sort of proto township art, basically, you know, his representation of like black reality or social realism in painting. And then I continued for my DEA, which is the equivalent of MPhil in France. I continued exploring the representation of the body in South African art, looked beyond race. So I looked at the work of Jane Alexander, Roger Hodgins, like different, you know, black and white artists. But I carried on with, in terms of like up until today, I'm continuing researching the work of George Hallett. So George Hallett was also a photographer whose work I investigated as part of my MPhil in France. And this here is a picture of Dumi Lefeni, who was a South African painter and sculptor, and painter and sculptor mainly. And I'm just putting some images to give you some of his work, to give you a sense of the kind of representation that he used to do, and also the anxiety of the sort of imagery that he produced. So this was done before he moved to exile in London. And George and Dumile and Louis Moholo, jazz musician, sort of lived together and supported each other as exiles in South Africa in London in the 70s and 80s. And the research I've been doing up until now is looking at how some of the work by George Hallett have been used by other artists, notably here in the case of Gavin Yanchis, his Freedom Hunters, dated 1976-77, who was referring to the Soweto uprising, where students rebelled against the fact that the South African government, the Bantu education department, wanted to impose on black students to study in Afrikaans rather than in English. And obviously we were talking about that with Natasha yesterday, where she was saying that the students actually wanted to study in their own languages, African languages, which also makes me think of the conversations that took place yesterday about, you know, languages. But basically, this image was sort of meant to raise awareness to, you know, of the situation in South Africa. So it's more or less contemporary to what happened in Soweto at the time, which was an event that really raised awareness on apartheid and the condition of, you know, black people and how white people were treating, you know, citizens, but particularly students in South Africa. So I've been looking at how the other artists have used George Hallett's work in their own practice. For instance, in this one, there's on the corner, on the top corner, there's a, an image that I showed earlier by George Hallett. And at the bottom is Dumile Feni, bottom left. And the other two images are by Peter Magubane, who documented the Soweto uprisings. So after I finished my research in Paris, I moved to Morocco and then went to England. And in England, I sort of encountered an art movement that I'd never heard about when I studied in France, and it completely shifted, or let's say, it really determined me to like continue on this exploration, and you know, continue to challenge the white, you know, art, the art institution as a white space. This is work. So when I moved to England, I worked at the Africa Center, and I started researching the archive of the Africa Center. And I saw that this in at the Africa Center they held the first exhibition of black artists in London in the early 80s. So that was, I think, 1982, an exhibition called Five Black Artists. And this exhibition, I mean, the exhibition and actually some of the work in the exhibition, particularly Eddie Chambers' Destruction of the National Front, was described by Rashida Rin as the emblematic or the sort of birth of the black art movement. So this piece shows, you know, a torn Union Jack reorganized as a swastika, and it is a founding stone for a radical agenda, as Rashida Rin described it. So the first black art exhibition in London after the exhibition Black Art and Done in Wolverhampton in 1981 took place at the Africa Center in 1982. And it featured five artists who, Rashida Rin writes, described themselves as descendant of African dispersed during the Atlantic slave trade, and explicitly identified themselves with the struggle of African people all over the world. And I'm quoting from the statement they produced, sort of catalog, which was more like a manifesto. And they were saying, "We feel for our brothers and sisters throughout the world who are victims of racial injustice. In developing our sense of some badness, we try to avoid blind mimicry." However, that doesn't mean that leading voices in the black art movement were perceived as a unique voice that could speak for all black artists. And Rashida Rin mentions that the Black Art Conference that was held in Wolverhampton in 1982 that attracted a large gathering of black artists from all over the country also provided a platform for black women artists to speak from their own perspective. So I'm just going to show a few images of the artists from the Black Art Movement. So this is where, so the movement was founded, I mean, some of the three key instigators of the movement were Eddie Chambers, Keith Piper, and Donald Rodney. So this is a work, Another Nigger Died Today, that addressed, you know, violence against black people in Britain in the 80s. Which it's sad to say something that, you know, we continue to see in the news in the States and also in England. Luckily in England to a lesser degree that what's happening in the States. Work by Donald Rodney, The Lords of Humankind. Another piece by Keith Piper, Black Assassin Saints. And what struck me, so after coming to the Africa Center, doing the research on the center's archive, seeing the work that was exhibited, was that there was a strong connection and dialogue between, visual dialogue between those artists and you know, the South African artists and the work that I had studied when I was a student and actually, Keith Piper, in an essay for the catalogue of an exhibition called A Sheep Called Jesus, that was, I think that was in Manchester, in, if I'm not mistaken, in 1991, mentioned that actually artists like Gavin Yanches inspired their practice. They were really, inspired by prior generation of artists. So for me, it was an interesting link, you know, having studied South African art, coming to England and seeing how there was a dialogue between black artists in Britain and artists in, predominantly black artists in South Africa. And there's a lot of reference, obviously, with the context, and it was the era of Margaret Thatcher, who called Nelson Mandela a terrorist. And again, a reference to how the banks were financing the, you know, benefiting from apartheid. Work by Tam Joseph, who's less active now, but The Spirit of the Carnival addresses the police violence against black people in the 80s and the frisk and search, which is basically police would stop black people and like search them, they were racially profiling black people, which is something that is still an issue today. So as I was saying, Rashid Arin identified a piece he wrote called The Success and Failure of Black Art, that artists like Lubey Nahimid and Sonia Boyce were in their own way developing a black perspective, but a female perspective. They were addressing concerns and positions, that were specific to black women. And by black women, black in the UK, we're referring to, I mean, at the time they were referring in the 80s to, African people, Caribbean people, and also South Asian artists. And Lubey Nahimid, in an essay that she wrote called I forgot the title, but basically addressing invisibility. And she wrote sort of a creative essay for the catalogue of Shades of Black, which is a book that was published in 2005. And she's crediting an artist called Claudette Johnson, who's still active today, from the Black Art Group, who decided to take all the women in another space, in order for us, so I'm quoting, in order for us to exchange with the issues most important to us. In visual terms, she adds, quoting, she said things about black women's bodies, experiences, and aspirations that change lives, end of quote. And these artists developed a black feminist perspective that reflected their time and had a significant influence on members of a subsequent generation of artists and curators. So this is an image of the first exhibition that Lubeina Himid organized in 1983 called Five Black Women, featuring Sonia Boyce, Lubeina herself, Claudette Johnson, Huria Nyati, and Veronica Ryan. So for me, when I found out about this exhibition and this black British discourse, it was something that really, that was never addressed when I lived in France. And all the reflection around, black feminism and even like cultural or post-colonial studies and all the writing by Stuart Hall or Paul Gilroy was not accessible in France. So it's like London and Paris is only 2 hours by train, but there was a huge gap in terms of scholarship and in terms of the thinking process and criticality. So that's something that really, based on my own experience of growing black in a white country and the racism that one experiences in this context, there were things that I experienced and I couldn't articulate. And when I moved to England and had access to this reading, I was able to articulate things in a less passionate but like more intellectual way. So this is Lubey Nahimid in the 80s, who was talking about how she was actually, in this clip, she's actually saying that white spaces are selfish, that the institution didn't want to share space, so she was already trying to, put together exhibitions by black artists. And the interesting thing in this context is actually that the artists took it upon themselves to organize them, to organize, and like for the first exhibition that I mentioned, Black Art and Done, they were still students, but they didn't need a curator to have their exhibition. They made a very powerful statement, I think. And for me, it's very moving because it's like their catalog is like photocopies, and they're saying that their work is not for sale, but like they were really making a powerful political statement, which in my view differs from the way contemporary African art functions as, with curators organizing exhibition, particularly if you think of the fact that the Black Art movement that included artists from Africa, the Caribbean, South Asian, self-organized exhibitions in the early 80s, is something that predates the Magiciens de la Terre, that was in 89, curated exhibition where, black artists and, artists from the Indian, the Oceania as well, where, there was a sort of discourse that was mediated by the white curators. So Lubena held two other exhibitions at the ICA called Battersea Art Center was Black Women Time Now, and at the ICA, The Thin Black Line. And then in 2011, she co-curated an exhibition by with Paul Goodwin that was a sort of selection of this, the three exhibitions that she put together in the 80s. And that also marked the beginning of making histories visible, even though the project that I'm working with, that I'm working on with Lubeina Himid started in 1999. It took it became stronger with this exhibition that she organized at the Tate. So I just put those images because that's when I moved to England, I had access to, black feminist theory and thought. These are some of the texts that have inspired my curatorial practice, that I've researched also and explored in my collaboration with a French-based journal called Africulture, and for which I was commissioned by BC Silva, who's a curator and founder of CCA Lagos. I think it was in wrote something in, 2007, for this exhibition called Like a Virgin, where she presented Lucy Azubuike and work by Zanele Moholi, and it's actually one of the first exhibitions in Africa that looked at homosexuality. So I wrote an essay for the exhibition and then continued engaging with Zanele Moholi in my exhibitions, notably this one that I curated in as part of the Hayward Touring exhibition in that took place between 2011 and 2013. So in the exhibition that I did in 11 and 13, there was also work by Elena Muzu, who was a asylum seeker who stayed in her attic and like didn't feel that she was safe to leave because she, if she was caught in Belgium, then she might have been sent back to Togo, I think she's from. Work very much inspired by Francesca Woodman. And work by Majida Khatari, who's a Moroccan artist based in Paris, and whose work may seem decorative, when you look at it, because it's really nice, etc. But it's also addressing an issue that was discussed by Houria Niati in the 80s. So Houria Niati was she's an Algerian artist based in London, and she was one of the first artists to address the exotization of Algerian women by French artists in this period, like Delacroix and Les Femmes d'Alger. So she was one of the first. She was an artist. She was an activist when she was younger. Was arrested in Algeria, then moved to England. So, and there was work as well by Zanele Moholy. And then I was invited by Beaux-Arts to curate an exhibition as part of the Summer of Photography in 2014 that addressed gender. Okay, so I'm going to put a small clip of the exhibition. It's basically to show the legacy of the practice of black women who were active in the 80s and how they've paved the way for younger curators like myself and the next generation of curators and black practitioners to sort of look at gender, black representation in art spaces. In this exhibition, I go quickly, it was important as well to bring some of the archive that Lubena has kept because, for her to realize those exhibitions in the 80s was very challenging because she faced a lot of hurdles. And we've got this material at the university that it was important for me to present in Brussels as well because it's Brussels is a space that has had quite, a lot of difficulties addressing the colonial past. So it was important to show that, there is a critical practice that exists, within black image making that, that dates, in this case from the 80s, but like in the essay that I wrote for the catalog, I was talking about what was happening in the 70s as well, because there was this idea that feminism or in art was something that was like very Eurocentric, and I tried to bring this black perspective into that. So I'm not sure it's. I'll go quickly, but basically, what I wanted to say, I don't know how long I have, but for people like Lubeina Himid, who practiced in the 80s with and people were, how do you say? They didn't pay so much attention to what she and other artists were doing in the 80s. And recently, she's been, there's with the Trump elections and in the UK, we had Theresa May and like all the, drama and like dramatic situations are happening today. There's been an interest in Britain for those black artists who were practicing in the 80s. And there was I was following on social media sort of rhetoric that came back that was, art is more important. It's more important than ever today because of Trump and because of Theresa May and because of Northern Rock, whatever. And it was just, for me, it was, the title of my presentation was just same old, same old. We were never in a safe place. Looks at the fact that as black practitioners, we've never been in a safe space in the art. So for us, it's like it's always been like a continued struggle to to have access to those spaces, but also to be critical of those spaces. And what I'm trying to do now, because I'm also reflecting on my own practice, and I'm reflecting on reflecting on what I see from contemporary art, and I'm troubled by issues like, you know, that by the fact that we, as African, we're sort of entering the mainstream, and like we have an African art fair, and like there's more visibility to artists. But at the same time, what is considered success is a new museum of contemporary art in Cape Town that sort of reproduces in its organization a sort of neo-colonial structure. And for me, that's problematic. So I'm more and more trying to explore other practice and collaborating with I'm looking at other forms of marginalizations with collaboration with a Romani artist called Delaine Nebas, and I want to explore this territory more, and also look at writing and thinking and practice of political scientist Françoise Vergès. So I know my time is off, but that's something that will be part of the Casablanca Biennial that I'll be working on, and the summer photography that I'm curating next year, where we'll be looking at 1960s. Protests in photography, but also contemporary visual activism. I think that's it.